in Jesus'
name.
You know, some ministry for you. I hope you enjoy it.
And today, I would just like to respond from Psalms 91. Trust in God. In Psalms 91, we're going to be done with verses 1 and 2, and also verses 11 through 16. And in that, Psalms 91, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in him will I trust. The psalmist is telling us, you know, to trust in God. And he said, he that dwelleth, if we continue to dwell in the presence of the Lord, in that secret place of the Most High, and that's what that secret place of the Most High is, where we are intimate with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And under and that and of the Most High shall abide, that means we shall stay under the shadow of the Almighty. You know, you have heard of, I know you probably have heard about the chickens, you know, when the chickens, they have the little chicks, and the mother hen will protect them, and she takes her wings and cover them. And this is like in a way to get you to understand what God is doing. He is covering us with his sovereignty. And in verse 2 it says, I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress. My God, in him will I trust. So we have to trust in God. We put all of our trust in God. You know, he is our protection in the midst of danger. He doesn't promise us a world free from danger, but he does promise he will help whenever we face danger. And in Psalms 34 and 7, the angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him, and he delivers them. And we want the angels of God. God has a host of angels, and he sends the angels to help us mortals. And we can't see angels, but we know that they're there because the word of God says it. And you can feel their presence. In some instances, people have seen angels. And it says in Matthew 4:6, he will command, Jesus will command his angels concerning you, and they will lift you up in his hands. So angels are protectors, sent from God, ministers and messengers sent from God. So there are angels, and the Bible speaks of angels in the Old Testament and also in the New Testament. And we'd like to just drop down to verse 11. There shall no, for he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in his hands, lest thou dash thy foot against stones. So God, he charges his angels to look over us, to keep us out of hurt, harm, and danger. And I can say of a surety that I haven't seen an angel, but I have felt the presence of an angel. And it did one time in my life, I was out, it was at about 10 o'clock at night. I went to the store and I came out, and it was a person out there with a gun pointed at me. The parking lot was empty. And suddenly this man appeared and said, Octavia said, I'll see you to your car. And I said, oh, okay. And really, at that time, I wasn't afraid because I didn't know what was going on. But the angel of the Lord sent this man. It was in the neighborhood, and he said, just get in the car and go ahead. So I got in my car and I took off, and the young guy with the gun, you know, he raised it and pointed at me. And that's about the time that I thought it. But I felt the presence of the angel, and I thought it was this guy. I mean, he hung around the neighborhood. He was a nice guy and everything. But the angel had directed that guy to come at me at that very moment. And so I know that was an angel, and several other things has happened. I haven't really, I haven't sung one, but I have strongly felt the presence of angels around me or an angel in my car. You know, when I'm driving, I work midnights and I had to go to work. And I could feel, I would say if I looked in the rearview mirror, I was sure I could see someone sitting there. The presence was so strong. So I just thank God for my angel, because in the area that I was going to work to wasn't very pleasant. But God was there, and I worked at midnight about 6 years, and he protected me every night that I went. And I just thank God for that. So angels are for real. In verse 11, for he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. And in that verse 12, that's where Satan was trying to test Jesus. And Satan misquoted verse 12 in Psalms 91. He misquoted it to God. And he was talking to the very Son of God. But he misquoted it to trip him up, to get him to do what he wanted to do. And so we have to know the Word of God. And when is it spoken, we got to know and understand what the Word of God is saying. And in verse 13, thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder. The young lion and the dragon shall thou trample underfoot. So he will give us the strength and the fortitude to do what we feel that we have to do with the unctions of the Holy Ghost, and the angels are telling us to do so and so. And he said, well, I really can't do this. I really can't do that. I'm afraid. I'm shaking and whatever. But the Holy Ghost and our angels will help us in our time of need. All we have to do is call on him. Call on Jesus, and he will dispatch us an angel. All we need is one. Amen. And we know that God has millions of angels. And we see in Revelation that millions and millions of angels are around the throne of God, glorifying God to the most highest. So their most important job is to praise and glorify God. And when God hastens or gives them an assignment, they go. But their main important job is to praise and glorify God. And that is what we are to do also. We're here to glorify God, glorify his presence. And we're also here to be a witness of him until his grace and his mercy in the name of Jesus. And we just thank God that, you know, the more, if the angels was praising God day and night and with loud voice, a host of angels, I mean, we can do that too. You know, we're going to have our trials and we're going to have our tribulations, but we got to know that we do have a companion. We do have someone that's inside of us, that's talking to us, leading us and guiding us. You know, all we have to do is have a listening ear and an open heart to hear what Jesus is saying to us. And in our times of need, and we're fearful, we're so afraid, you know, we can't even think, did you just know within you that he's right there with us? If he's not there, the angels are there. Amen. And they're his personal angels that he sends to help us. And, you know, this is very, you know, what we should do, amen, and myself, you know, to stay in the Word of God and see what God is talking to us about. You know, he talks to us over the pulpit and through our friends and neighbors and everything, but the one true Word comes from the Bible, his Word. And, you know, at the verse 16, he says, with long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. He said, after everything that he has said in the 91st Psalm, if we abide, if we trust in Jesus, with long life will I satisfy him, or he will satisfy us, and he will show us his salvation. And that's really what it's all about. You know, the salvation of the Lord. You know, we have to, if you're going to abide with someone, or you're going to stay with someone, and you're going to depend on someone, you have to get to know that person. And in order to get to know Jesus, you know, you have to confess your sins, just ask Jesus to forgive you of your sins and cleanse you and to come into your life. And he will do that because he is already, he's already done it, but he will personally do it for you when he was on the cross and when he died. He did that for us to set us free from our sins. So we're all done, but he wants you. He wants to hear it from you, Lord, to forgive me. He is a forgiving God, and he is a God that you can trust in. So we just really love Psalms 91. It is so beautiful. But the thing that God, that we know that we have angels that live among us, and then we have ministering angels, we have praising angels, and we know in the scriptures the angels, a host of angels came when Jesus was born and ministered to the shepherds in the field. And you know, I know you have read that, but in many instances in the Bible, from the Old Testament to the New, it tells of the angels that have intervened in the affairs of men. And with kings and people that were doing wrong, they have interfered and made it right with God. So we want to be right with God and do his bidding and do what he would have us to do and just be there, just abide. And when I say abide, I said it before, we want to stay in his presence. And that's, we do that through prayer, through reading the word, through praising him, and we can just stay, and we make it a habit in our lives, and we can stay, and we can abide under his mighty wings. And we like to, in Psalms, in Matthew 18 and 10, and it talks about the little children. And see that you do not despise one of these little ones, for I shall tell you that in heaven their angels always see the face of our Father who is in heaven. And he is talking about the little children. He says, Jesus says, forbid the children not to come unto him. Children are treasures. There are arrows. That are sent by God to us to be a help, to be someone that we can love, someone that we can just lead in righteousness, help them to know about Jesus and what Jesus will do for them. We pray for our little children, our children, little, small, big, and whatever. We pray for them and we cover them with the precious blood of the Lord, because there's so much that is going on in this day. And so we have to, I know my great-grandchildren have great-grandchildren, you know, I made that I talk to them constantly about God and how to keep themselves from the evil things that may be going on in the streets. Because it's different things that are going on. I let them know to trust in God. And we pray over them and pray for them. You know, that the cover them with God's complete protection. Let their angels to be encamped around them. You know, so it's very important that we give our children, you know, the ammunition to protect themselves. A lot of times someone may not be around, but God is there, and they have to know. They have to trust in Jesus in whatever is going on, if they're afraid or what have you. And, you know, God is a loving God, and he loves his children. And a lot of, you know, we all have to come up to that point in some instances. And the Bible also tells us in Hebrews 1:14, it says, are not all angels ministering spirits sent by God? God is what I have said before. He sends his personal angels down here to us, to minister unto us, to a lot of times to help us in different situations, things that, you know, we say, oh, well, I can't do it, I can't handle it. But he sends help. Help is on the way, whatever. You just call on Jesus. He knows what the problem is, but he wants to hear from you. And he will interfere. And we just give God, we just praise him for all that. But, you know, a lot of people, like I say, you know, some people don't believe in angels and some people do. But we have to be careful because Hebrews 13:2 tells us to be mindful of who we entertain. Because we may be entertaining an angel. Some a stranger we meet on the street or a stranger that come to our house and, you know, we're a little apprehensive for whether we're going to talk to them or whether we're going to let them in. But he says, you know, to be friendly, because you never know, we may be, you know, entertaining angels unaware. But, and I would say in a case like that, someone that comes to your door at night, you know, and do whatever, say whatever, you know, ask God, is this for real? You know, is this something that you have sent to me? If it's not, you can tell him to go right now, you know. So we have to be really practical, but just be aware. And if you you're saved and you have the Holy Ghost, he will tell you whether this is a friendly person or an evil person. And you have all the equipment to take care of both of them, friendly or evil, in the name of Jesus. So we just want you to just abide in his presence, abide in his word. And he is our teacher. Jesus is the great teacher. He's a great physician. And he's right there at your beck and call. I mean, you don't say every time you have a hangnail, you know, you try to pull his chain. No, I'm talking about something that's really serious, you know, and that is going to affect your lives in different aspects. So we want to really just comprehend Jesus, comprehend what he is doing to us. You know, he's sending his private angels to come and minister to us. We have the Holy Ghost that ministers and tells us what to say. So he is looking out for his people. And we are the people, are his people. And if you're not, like I said before, you can just ask him to come into your life, and he will do that. Just you confess your sins, and you don't have to get out the whole list and go down the list, because he knows what you have done wrong, what I have done wrong, whatever. Just, Lord, you asked him to forgive you of all your sins. Wash me in your precious blood. Come into my life and abide within me. And that's basically all you have to do. Once you do that and you realize that he is in your heart, he's in your life, and you trust in him, then you get into your word and let him talk to you. And then, you know, and if you feel with the Holy Ghost as he's talking to you out of his word, he's going to explain to you what you're reading. Yeah, so it's simple. Jesus had made his word very simple, that no one can err if they just have a listening ear and a listening heart. I am so glad to have been able to be with you on today, but we just like you to know that someone cares for you. Jesus cares for you, and we care for you. We care because we want, you know, that's why we bring you the word of God and what God is saying on today. And I admonish to you, get your Bible off the shelf, dust it off, and start reading, you know, about, you know, reading and listening to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And I tell you a little secret. Start in the New Testament. Start with John. And I think he will fill in a lot of spaces for you. Thank God for you listening. Thank God for you being with us. And again, I am Dr. Octavia Davis of the Evangelist Dispatch Ministries. And our program is Someone Who Cares. God bless you.
Someone Who Cares with Dr. Octavia Davis. From the Evangelist Dispatch Ministry, for prayer or words of encouragement, please call 313-401-1527. Thank you.
This is Dr. Vicki Archie from Christos Ministries, and I just want to thank everybody for tuning in on today. I'm just so happy, you know, in the name of Jesus, that it appears that he is blessing the saints. And I just feel the blessings, and I'm asking for your prayers. So I'm going to go into my teaching on the day. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. I was thinking, when I started out with ADI Ministries, I told you guys that I would teach on the ologies. And so I'm going to teach today on eschatology. But, you know, the ologies, you know, we have theology, which is the study of God, Christology, the study of Christ. It's in the Bible. Just look in the front. They are all broken down. That's what the Bible is broken down into. The doctrine of the Holy Spirit, which is pneumatology, doctrine of man, anthropology, the doctrine of sin, hermetology, the doctrine of salvation, soteriology, the doctrine of the angels is angelology, and the doctrine of church, ecclesiology. We are the ecclesia, the called out. The doctrine of the last things, eschatology. Look in front of your Bible, I'm sure you'll see it. So I'm going to take you guys to Revelation chapter 20. So Revelation chapter 20, verse 12 says, "And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. And the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of these things which were written in the books, according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it. And death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. And they were judged, every man according to their works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death." In the last days, eschatology, last days, apocalypse, the end times, God is going to pass a couple of judgments. There are two that is really important to the body of Christ. The white throne judgment, which I just read to you in Revelation 20:11, that is for the people that don't love God, don't give him no honor, just believe that there's no God. You know, maybe just say the atheists, whoever. But then the judgment seat of Christ is for the Christians. It's for the ones that love him. So it's two different ones. The judgment seat of Christ for the Christians to save, and then the white throne judgment for the wicked dead. Now, it's important that we learn about these judgments, because the body of Christ, what I'm finding, that they're not studying. You know, the Bible tells us in 2 Timothy 2:15 to study to show thyself approved. Who? To who? Unto God. A workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. So we got to rightly divide this word of truth, especially if you're going to teach it. I remember the reason why I chose to talk about this on the day was I talked to a deacon, and we were talking about the judgment seat of Christ and the white throne judgment, and he told me he was going to appear at the white throne judgment. I said, "Really?" I said, "Well, I'm not going to be in the white throne judgment. You're going to be there by yourself." Because at the white throne judgment, he's going to wake up the dead from the sea, wherever they are, and, you know, he's going to judge them And then they're going to be thrown in the lake of fire, which is the second death. So how are we going to be there? We're not going to be having no second death. So the bottom line is, I know it's some teaching out there that there's no hell, but the Bible contradicts that. The Bible, like I said in Revelation 20:11, just told you. It said, what, death and hell? It said, and death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. Gehenna, fire. It's all going to come back. Second time around, third time, whatever. But now the judgment seat of Christ, this is where the Christian is going to appear. So we're going to look at Romans 14 and 10. Help me, Holy Ghost. I want the real teacher to show up and help me. Because, you know, just finding these scriptures sometimes can be a problem, unless you know your Bible. So I want Romans 14 and 10. I just want to give a shout out to my production staff, the ones that are doing everything as far as having us on TV and looking good. That's London, Washington, and Irene Washington. Cool, guys. Okay, Romans 14 and 10. Right here. Okay, here we go. Romans 14 and 10 says, but why do thou judge thy brother? Or why do thou set at naught thy brother? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. So I know they're saying, well, we are. But see, this is Roman. You know, it's written to the church. This is the New Testament. So when he said, we shall all stand, that's the ones that love him. That's the ones that confess him. And if you notice and remember, Romans 10 and 9 says that, you know, you got to confess him, you know, for salvation. You got to believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and you will have salvation. So now we come around to Romans 14, so that's why you know it's for the body of Christ. So it said we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. And then you, if you remember the Bible, it always repeats itself. If you find one scripture in the Bible, then you can go somewhere else and you're going to see that same scripture. So to support Romans 14 and 10, we have 2 Corinthians 5 and 10. And Corinthians come right after Romans, so I shouldn't have no problem finding that. 2 Corinthians 5 and 10. You're going to see the same thing. This is for the next generation. Get your pen and your papers out. And let's learn this thing so that you will be able to teach it and teach it correctly. Okay, 2 Corinthians 5 and 10 says, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that every one may receive the things done in his body according to that he had done, whether it be good or bad. See that? We shall all appear before the judgment seat of Christ. But not everybody. He's talking to the ones that love him. He's talking to the body of Christ. He called out the ecclesia. But it also says that we will be judged for the things done in our body. And that has been a conversation over the years, because people are saying, but I thought he threw everything into the sea of forgetfulness, that he won't bring it up no more. It's true, because the Bible, every word is right. His word is settled in heaven. But the bottom line is, you're going to be judged for the things on your body. I'll give you an example. I used to smoke cigarettes, okay? So now I stopped that, because I know that this body is the temple of God, and he's not going to dwell in an unclean temple. Some people may differ, but I just believe I want to keep my temple clean. So therefore, he's going to say, come on, my daughter, come and receive eternal life. But I remember a time you were smoking cigarettes. You was putting nicotine in your body. It says right on the pack that it's deadly, but you did it. He said, but I forgave you. Hey, now, that's when he said, but I threw it in the sea of forgetfulness. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. I am just so excited about it. He's going to receive me because he loves me and I love him. So those are two of the things that we're going to look for in the last days, in times, the apocalypse, eschatology. And another thing about the last days we're going to look at Matthew 25, where he's going to separate the nations. Now, a lot of people saying that this is the rapture, but I decided to not believe that. Because Matthew 25 is clear that it's the separation of nations. There is a commentary on this that says that, but then people will say, but that's man. But then the Bible is going to back it up. The Bible is going to back it up in 1 Thessalonians 4. It will be 1 Thessalonians. Because with the rapture, there is not going to be the sheep on the right and the goats on the left. The rapture is going to be, remember guys, the trumpet is going to sound. The dead in Christ is going to rise first. So he's not separating anybody. That's a problem. It was so bad that I went to my pastor. I said, Pastor, why is people teaching that this Matthew 25 separation of the nation is the rapture? And he told me I was exactly right. So we're going to look at Matthew 25. It's going to be 25 and 31. Let's look at that real fast. When the Son of Man shall come in his glory, and all the holy angels with him, then shall he sit upon the throne of glory. And before him shall be gathered all nations, and he shall as a shepherd divide his sheep from the goats. And he shall set the sheep on the right hand and the goats on the left. So right there. People are preaching that this is the rapture. He's separating them, but he said all nations right here. Matthew 25 and 32. And before him shall be gathered all nations, and I guess that's how we're getting this. Okay, let's look at the commentary. Like, I know man wrote it, but it makes sense because we're going to back it up with Thessalonians. 25 and 31, it says, the judgment of the nations conclude our Lord's prophetic discourse. The judgment of all nations must be distinguished from the great white throne judgment as he sit at the end of the millennium, because basically after 1,000 years the devil's going to be bound, he's going to be loose, and then you know all of these things are going to take place, the judgment after 1,000 years, which 1,000 years is called the millennial reign. When he said the nations, these people living through the great tribulation on earth at the time of Christ's return, the main thing that I want to say to you is, let's look at this. The basis of their acceptance seems to be treatment of the least of these, my brethren, the saved of the great tribulation. He says, do not get the separation of the nations mixed up with the rapture. So in this Matthew 25, you know, like whatever I'm teaching on, don't take my word for it, you know, get your Bible out and study it for yourself. But this Matthew 25, verses 31 down, is talking about separation of nations. Those are going to be the ones that are left during the tribulation period. Just said it right there, the tribulation. Well, we know the tribulation period is 7 years. 3.5 years of tribulation, 3.5 years of great tribulation. And some people will be saved during the tribulation. Now, we have people also that say they're not going to be saved during the tribulation period. But then we got a part in Revelation, I'm going to talk about it next week, that says, who are these that appear in heaven in the white robes? And it clearly says that these are the ones that came out of the great tribulation. There will be people saved. That's what the Bible says. As a matter of fact, it's chapter 7 when it talks about the 144,000. It tells you that some of them will be saved during the tribulation period. Some of them decide not to believe that, but I believe it because the Bible says it. Now let's look at 1 Thessalonians. We're going to wrap it up. 1 Thessalonians 4, which is the rapture, which lets us know that the rapture is not the separation of the nations. Matthew 25, didn't it say the separation of the nations? How is that the rapture, when the rapture is clearly talked about in 1 Thessalonians? where is it? Okay, here's Timothy. So I know it's Timothy. Thessalonians should come before that. Yeah. First Thessalonians 4, I'm in 2. Praise the Lord, everybody. I just thank you so much for tuning in. The Bible is just so interesting. I love it. Everything is right. God is not a person that he should lie, or the Son of Man that he should repent. His word is truth. So let's look at Thessalonians 4, I believe 16. Okay, we're going to say 4. Let me just start with 4:13. 4:13 says, "But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, then also we sleep, and Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you, by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep." Okay, and here's 16. "For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first." That's the rapture. Amen. 4:16. "For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and bring with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we forever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words." And with that, I'm going to close my Bible. I know I'm about running out of time, but it's clear that Matthew 25, the section of the nations, those are the ones that's going to be saved during the tribulation period. And then 1 Thessalonians 4 says that God himself is going to descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trump of God. How is that the same thing? He's not going to put nobody on the right and the left, and then that's just rapture. No, he's just going to be caught up in the name of Jesus, because we all know that rapture is not in the book, but it says caught up. And so with that, I just thank you guys for listening. Tune in the next time, because I will be teaching on various things, like I say, theologies, the covenants, and I hope I help somebody. In Jesus' name, I thank you. Amen. This is Dr. Vicki Archie, Christos Ministries. You can view me if you want to look at this message again on YouTube under Christos Ministries. C-H-R-I-S-T-O-S. Christos, God gave me that name because Christos, Jesus Christ, for instance, Christ is not a last name. Christ is the anointed one. And Christos is the anointing of Jesus Christ. That's why it's called Christos, because he was anointed by God to bring forth the word, to raise the dead, to heal the sick, give sight to the blind, everything. He was anointed to do that. Messiah is also anointed. In Hebrew, Christos is the Greek word for anointed. And this is how this name Christos came about, because of the anointing of Jesus Christ. And if you remember, the scriptures say that it's because of the anointing that yokes are destroyed. Thank God for Jesus. I'm just so happy to be one of his disciples. I love the Lord. He is healing our bodies. He's helping us financially. He's given us a brain and knowledge to come forth. Because without him, I couldn't do nothing. Without him, how could I even remember a scripture? So we have to give God credit. He is awesome in all that he does. And I just thank you. So if you want to have a program on YouTube or television, you can call this number. And if you want to get in touch with me, the same number, which is 248-701-0885. Again, that's 248-701-0885. If you want to sit down and teach like I'm doing, you can call this number, and I'm sure we can work it out. And if you want to get in touch with me, you can call this number. And again, you can review this message on YouTube. Thank you for listening.
Semi-truck is coming, and you just said, well, I'm staying right here because, you know, God is so cool. He never let that truck run over me. And then, lo and behold, you keep standing there, and that truck runs over you. So I got into the conversation like that, you know. And then another thing I went to is just, we have to learn how to listen, follow directions, listen to what God has for us to do. He has instructions for us. And I was saying that it's like standing there and you're just constantly digging this hole in the ground because of not paying attention, because of not giving God attention, because of not, you know, doing what you're supposed to do, because of ignoring everything around you, or just even trying to do the right thing. It's, I'm going to keep digging this hole. And you keep digging that hole. And I'm not talking about digging a hole for somebody else, because you dig a hole for somebody else, it's guaranteed it's going to come back. But you're constantly digging all the dirt off around you till there's no, do what you're going to do. You're going to fall in the hole. And so it's that comes from, and I got on that subject because it was like a lecture about being not paying attention because you don't want to. Ignoring the instructions when it's coming to you because you just don't want to. If somebody's giving you some instructions, you just tune them out. So then I got on the subject about how God, even in the midst of our ignorance and attitude, because of his grace and because of his mercy, he'll bail us out. Or even at this, Colonel, if I'm the kind of person just do whatever, don't care, and because, but I'm always around you, right? Mm-hmm. This man of God is praying, and God is telling you, the very fact that I'm in the midst of you all the time, I'm being blessed, even if I'm not right. Because I'm sitting here with Colonel. God, and I don't let anything happen to the Colonel. And it's just like being somewhere where the blessing of the Lord is, and that's like either go to church, or you got parents that are Christians, or you got somebody in your family that's saved, or you're around some truly saved believers, and you are still reaping the benefits of the goodness of somebody else because of the grace of God, and because you are in the midst of godliness. So there goes the grace is something that you receive that you don't deserve. So I got the point where, you know, if we obey God as he says, mm-hmm. and be obedient and love him like he loves us and trust him, he promised he would take care of us. And it's not because that is so good, that we're so good, that we're so righteous, that we're so holy, because he said that's what he's going to do. And it's because of his grace and his mercy.
You know, I'm enjoying what you're saying, but you know, but there are people out there that you know, their so-called Christianity to be lazy. And, you know, there's so many things in the scripture that fight against that type of thing. Because there was somebody saying in the Bible that, oh, I have faith. God's going to do this. God's going to do that. And I'm going to live by my faith, which is a good thing. Mm-hmm. But Paul turned around and said, well, you show me what you can do by your faith, and I'm going to show you what I can do by my faith through my works. Mm-hmm. So it's just like when we have a child and we give that child, and I'm not talking about a little baby, but this is them big enough to really take care of themselves. We give them food, shelter, clothing, we give them deodorant, all the amenities that they need. But yet and still they walk around dirty and stinking all the time. Now, how much water you have, I don't care how much soap you have or anything around, until you get up enough gumption to go and use it for yourself, it's not going to do you any good. Right. God wants to make sure that we have all of our needs met. But he also expects us to do certain things that he is telling us to do. And except you are working in his vineyard, there is no way in the world that we can truly claim that we are having the faith that we're supposed to have. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I asked a question to one of my professors the other day, and I said, because we were talking about something, I said, you know, people talk about how much of a Christian they are and how much faith they have in God and how much they love God. I said, but what happens when you have someone saying that? And they never even want to go to church. Mm. He basically said, well, that person just outright lying. Mm. So when we want to let people know what type of faith and commitment we have to God, we're going to do it. Can you imagine having a husband and he comes in, he says anything to you, he leaves, he does this, he brings some food home, a little bit of money, and you ask him, well, do you love me? Well, yeah, you love me. Mm-hmm. But he never says, I love you. Mm-hmm. So you want to be loved. And you only know it if you love somebody, you're going to say from time to time, I love you. And God is the same way with us. He provides for us, but he expects us to do certain things to, I won't say to earn being awarded his blessings. Mm-hmm. Now, you might be blessed, and if I hang around you, you're going to give me some of those blessings, or mm-hmm. let me share some of those blessings. Mm-hmm. But I can't live off of your prayers always.
Always, man. That is true. Now that's the next step. But it's very interesting and kind of a sad thing that sometimes people do feel that that's what they need to do. They want to. They feel that I'm living off the goodness of, because you know if I'm around Dr. Bishop all the time. And I know he say, I'm gonna, you know, I'm safe, and then I can just pop out here and do whatever I want to do. But y'all, we have to answer to God, each one of us, for our own selves. So by the time that time comes, when God asks you that question or talks to you, well, you know, I was with Dr. Milburn. He gonna say, well, no, but this is you have to answer for what you did or what you're doing. Do you love me? Did you love me? Did you listen to me? Did you obey me? Did you follow my commandment? Did you do it? Then what is the answer going to be?
Depart from me, ye workers of iniquity. I never knew you. And we have to understand that God gives us things to do. This is the reason why, whether we are a part of a specific ministry, as a part of our church or some organization, God gives us all to be ministers if we're truly his children. Mm-hmm. So we have to understand that there are things that we have to do. And sometimes there are even people that sit around and we talk about grace and mercy. Well, God's just going to endow me with grace. He's going to put his mercy on me. But there's an old story about a guy that went to a retreat. And his mind was made up, I'm not doing anything unless God tells me to do it. I'm going to live my life only when God tells me to do something. So they gave him the itinerary and said, well, you know, lunch is at such and such a time. I'll just say it is at 12 o'clock, so you can come down at 12 o'clock. So come 11:30, they came around and said, well, you know, half an hour, you be down for lunch. 12 o'clock, he didn't go down for lunch. 12:30, somebody came up and said, well, you know, we had lunch starting a half an hour. You're coming down. I'm waiting on God to tell me what to do. I'm waiting on him. I'm not going to do it unless God tells me. Well, late in the afternoon, said, so, you know, we got dinner coming up. Do you want to come? I'm waiting on God. 6 o'clock, dinner's being served. You coming? I'm waiting on God. I'm waiting on God. By the next day, they kept coming back saying the table is spread and the feast is going on. And the guy said, I'm waiting on God. So somebody said, well, are you hungry? And he said, well, yeah, I'm hungry. He said, well, what do you think God's trying to tell you? So a lot of times we want to make things so complicated. Mm-hmm. But the gospel is a simple thing. It is not hard to live with him. And he even said in his word that if this gospel be hid, it is hid from those that are lost. So we have to understand that God makes things plain. He makes it simple. He makes it easy. And this is what he said in his word. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. And if you simply listen to what God is telling you and not what everybody else is trying to say or trying to figure out what you think God is saying for you, shut up sometime and listen, and he will work it out with grace and with mercy.
Wow, that sounds like you need to be still and pay attention and listen.
Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord work sometime, but sometime we need to go to where the salvation is working.
Yes. Ooh-wee. Now that's a big word in itself. I truly can appreciate everything that you said about that, because and we hope that people will listen and be more attentive to the Word of God. Like you said, you need to go where it is. And it's interesting how you say, if you're around the, you know, the older people say, yeah, you can bring the horse to the water,
but you can't make him drink it.
And so if he dies from dehydration and thirst, what do you do? You know, just, and so that's, you know, wow. Sometimes it is a hard thing, I would say, when there maybe be someone in your midst. Even sometimes we talk about our children or our relatives or even the ministry. Even the pastor's constantly giving this message out. Is anybody listening? Is anybody doing it? Is anybody following? Are they following these instructions? You come back time and time and time again, you hear the word, the true word of God, over and over and over again. Did you leave it at the church when you left? Or did you take it? Did you accept it in your mind? Is it in your heart? And are you trying to abide by the word of God? And, you know, God is so good to say, you know, he takes care of us even when we're undeserving. He wakes us up every morning. He blesses us with a shelter over our head. He blesses us with jobs, ministry, you know, friends, family. This is much that he blesses us with that sometimes we don't take for granted. We take for granted. Many times we don't even think about it. As a matter of fact, we don't even think about when the good things do come, that God is the one that allowed that to come. Even if he said, oh, I'm so smart. I'm so intelligent. I. Really. If God hadn't given you that brain, given you the brain, and if he hadn't allowed you to be able to understand what you're doing, if he didn't bless you with the strength and the mind to know how to do it, where do you think did it come from? It came from God. So we have, it first and foremost in our lives, is to acknowledge God for who he is and to thank him, praise him, honor him, and not lean to our own understanding. That was a part of our conversation, too. We lean to our own understanding. We get in a lot of trouble. That's going back to, I'm going to keep digging this dirt out like this, and you're digging it even up from under your own feet so much that you fell in a hole. You fell in a hole, and then you expect someone to come and extend your hand to pull you out if it's too deep, and you get in there. Now, this is like proverbial. If you fall in a hole too deep, a physical person cannot get you because they don't want to fall in the hole too. So here we are back again. God's sitting there waiting for you to come around so he can, okay, you got it now? Okay, let me get you out of this. And maybe after this situation, you can know to come to me first. You can listen to what I have to tell you to do and how to do it. Because God will tell you how to even do things. Just like you said, the man keeps saying, wait on God. You have to give God credit for giving you common sense enough to know. That's okay. I gave you common sense, preacher. What are you going to do? You're hungry? The food's sitting right here. Wait on God. What do you want me to say? Eat? Mm-hmm. Are you sure that it'll be me when I tell you to eat? How are you going to be sure? So it's almost like some things that God has given us is inborn, instilled in us already. It's almost God's common sense, okay?
Oh, yeah. And see, hearing what God is telling us is so very, very important. And even the scripture said, well, actually Jesus said in the scripture that his sheep know his voice, mm-hmm. and a stranger will not follow. So we have to hear the word of the Lord, and quite often in life that word comes from the man or woman of God. And it's the same thing that Paul said. Those things we have both learned and received and heard and seen do, and the God of peace shall be with us. Now, we are saved by grace.
Yes.
We are saved. Nothing saves us by grace and the promise of the Lord Jesus Christ. But this tender loving mercy come because we are fallible as humans. So we sit, we fall, we do something, we think something we shouldn't be thinking. His mercies come in, and it covers us. And Jesus stepped up and said, well, I shed my blood for them. I shed my blood again for her, for all, for everything that they're going to do. But I need them to understand they have to adhere to my things so complicated. And you want to shut down our ear. And here's the big problem with a lot of people. Because we don't want to accept what God is saying for us. We want to do our own thing. What was the scripture that you said? By not being the understanding. So when we need our own understanding, then we have to remember that our thoughts are not his thoughts.
That's right.
Our ways are not his ways. So his thoughts, his ways are higher than of ours, than the heavens are above the earth. So when we understand that, we have to open our ear. And I don't care if you've been in ministry for one day or 100 years, we can still learn from God.
Exactly.
And we need to have open ears to hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Amen. It kind of reminds me of a message that I did the other day. And it's like God gave it to me. And as we go, learn and grow, get older, we say, they'll perish for the lack of knowledge. But it's not just book knowledge. It's not just going to school knowledge. We need all of that. But there's another kind of knowledge that comes from the Holy Ghost that God will come and tell you. Because my thing is, how do I know what I'm supposed to do if I don't even know what it is, where I'm at? What I don't know the situation. And only God can come in and give you that knowledge that no man can give you. And you go, oh, wow, the Lord, you know, then all of a sudden this thought comes to your mind to the situation on what to do, how to do it, how to handle it. And that's because God has knowledge for us that no man can give it to you. And you just won't have it yourself. Like you said, do not lean to your own understanding. But if you give yourself to the Lord, allow the Lord to come in and teach you and be within you, then God will automatically send that Holy Spirit, that word, that knowledge that you need to have to lead and guide you. And even things that you're not even unaware, He'll make you aware of these things. Then He'll tell you what to do. He'll cover you. And then many times, because of the situation, we'll look after the fact. You're like, wow, God took care of that, and I didn't even know.
Mm-hmm.
So it's another kind of knowledge, people. And I call it, is it your knowledge, or is it God's knowledge? What kind of knowledge are we getting? We need all of that, but we need the knowledge of God. It's not the knowledge of going to school, getting those books. It's not the whole package. There's a package that God has, a special knowledge. And He said He will teach you of things that are secret, that people, no man knows. He'll teach you those things and tell you what to do and show you where to go. That's best.
And you know, even the scripture lets us know that any man lack understanding, let him ask of God.
Mm-hmm.
And that's telling us that He will give it to us. He wants us to understand what He is trying to say for us. And if we simply, again, we have to keep our ears open and realize, regardless of what type of degrees we have, how much schooling we've had, that we still don't know everything. And I mean one thing about myself, and everything that I've learned, the more I learn, the more I realize, the less I know.
Mm.
So the more I learn, the more I realize I need to learn other things.
Yeah.
So when we open our ears to what God is saying, and see, this is where the Holy Ghost comes in. This is part of the grace and the mercy.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Because we have things that come up before us, and the Word comes to us, and the Word may have came to us last month, last year, 10 years ago. But when a situation arises, we may have basically forgot about that Word, but the Holy Ghost,
yes,
will bring it back to our,
yes,
remembrance.
Really, yes.
And when He begins to speak and we listen, whatever that situation is, He's going to move it.
Amen.
And we get in sometimes situations that happen on the spur of the moment.
Mm-hmm.
It could be an accident. It could be falling off a roof, which I almost did.
Ooh.
One time. Actually, I fell on the roof, and my feet slipped down. I felt my toes go over the edge of the roof.
Oh, my goodness.
And all I could say was, Jesus. And just as I said, Jesus, I came to a dead stop.
Mm-hmm.
And I was able to get pulled up from where I was. But this is part of what God does for us.
Mm-hmm.
But we have to have the understanding that in all things, we must lean and depend on Him.
Oh, my goodness. Wow, you have about 4 minutes left. I knew it. Oh, see, you bring it all back around the full circle.
Well, I'm just glad to be here today. And Sister Lynn, we have to get together more often. Like I said, I know my schedule is so very crazy. I couldn't even make it to the last thing that you're doing. But I thank God that you still put up with me, still deal with
me.
And, you know, you don't have no idea how appreciative I am of you and what you're trying to do. And I know that you're listening to the Word of God. And as God speaks, you're doing your best to adhere to what He is saying. And I just want to tell the people out there that when you hear the Word of God, hold on to it. Because I'm going to tell you, I might be wrong. Sister London might be wrong. Your pastor could be wrong. I'm not saying he is or she is, but any man could be wrong. But when the Word of God comes forth, it's something about when it comes forth, it touches our heart.
Yes.
It becomes relative in all types of ways. Mm-hmm. And we know beyond a shadow of a doubt, we know that that Word has come for us. We may be in a room with 1,000 people, and when that Word comes, it may not touch anybody else, but we know when that Word is for us. So our job is to simply heed to that which God is speaking. And sometimes He's telling us to do something which may not make sense to other people, but you need to step out on faith. And when you do that, when you truly step out on faith, listening to His Word, I guarantee you that He will make a way.
Amen.
Regardless of what anybody else says.
Amen. Amen. Wow.
So we need to simply follow God's Word. You know what? And sometimes, and I like to say, I did this last time, sometimes if we say, well, we need an instruction book, I got news for it. Here it is right now.
Amen.
Everything you need, every situation life, it is in this book. Now, it's not going to talk about some MTV. It's not going to talk about, what is it, Club 51 or whatever club it is. It may not say that specifically, but you can take the things that happen in those and you can find those type of instances in this book.
Right.
And if you simply follow His Word, like they said, thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against thee. Mm-hmm. And if I'm holding your word in my heart, God, I know that you're going to do what I need to have done.
Yes.
So I think it's about time for us to get out of here. We have just another minute. But again, I want to thank you for coming out. Thank you for standing in for my other co-host today. But, you know, I just want to pray very quickly, because there's so many people out there that aren't listening, and we just need God to do what He needs to do for us.
Mm-hmm.
So, Heavenly Father, in the mighty name of Jesus right now, Lord, this is Passion Week that we're recording this program, and because it is a reminder to us of all that you have done, all that you said, all that you've given, that we might have a chance to enjoy that which is in your grace and in your mercy. So, Lord, those that are listening to the sound of our voices, we would ask that you would touch them right now. Open up their ears, open up their eyes, and might see your blessings, Lord, and understand that you have the hand, you have all power in your hand, and you will bless them in whatever way they need it, but they don't have to depend on anybody else, but simply continue and walk on your solid foundation. And if they do this, oh God, you will make a way, because you are the way maker.
Yes.
And do this, we will, Lord, continue to say yes to your will, and yes to your way. We will praise you, Lord. We will stand on the mountaintop and let them know that you are the true and living God.
Yes.
Again, God, we thank you. So help us right now. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So in all that you do, we need you to stand on God's word. And remember, whatever it is that you do, don't do it out of emotion. Do according to that which He speaks. And whatever you do, it must be done from the heart. I'm your host, Dr. Don Milgren, and my co-host today is none other than
London.
Oh, yeah. Sister London, my friend, my sister in the Lord. Have a good day, and may God bless you in every good work.
You so rough and tough, because God got you where you do have it going on. Now, and you may not even think that you're there and you have it going on, but you have it going on. So that is His job. So once you get that in your mind and understand, okay, this thing is all out of whack for some reason, and I'm trying to get over this bridge,
I'm trying to get over this bridge. Because when I get over that bridge, my next step, my promotion, my this, that, is over that bridge. Then here come, okay, the bridge right in the middle, the next step, it's trying to fall in. Then you got people calling over, you pulling and tugging on you, oh, I need this, I need that, help me, da, da, da. And then, so you're in the middle of the situation, getting pulled all directions. Now, sometimes you have to take care of these things. But don't give up, because it doesn't mean that it's over and that you're not gonna make it. So that business that you want, that education that you want, that talent, skill that you have, that you want to build, you want to put out there, you know, and all this social media now, it's almost really, it's all, you can't help but just get on out there and do what you gotta do. Say what you gotta say. But understand that in the midst of moving through that tunnel vision, going on that straight line, trying to make sure you make it, deterrence will try to come to throw you off. But guess what? You can make it. We are here to tell you that you can make it. I lost passenger, and my phone died, and that's my fault. And hopefully I'll get her back. But here, so we just want to say that. I want to say I made it. And so in so many ways, I know I made it. And there's so many other things that I want to do. And I'm sure you feel the same way. There's so many things you want to do. Well, we're here to tell you that you can. And through Jesus, he said, you can do all things through Christ. I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. Well, he's just telling you right there that you will. So in the midst of that, you just pray for good health. You pray for a good mind. You pray for direction. Keep the faith in God. Ask God to lead you and tell you which way to work, how to work it. And those are really the instructions out of the Bible. If you do those things, guess what? You're going to make it. Be bold. Be strong. And believe. And if God tells you something, believe he did. Someone's like, I don't really know. You know, God called me to do that. Well, if God called you to do it, and just don't back down. Just go. Have faith in God and just go. And he will take you to every point. Hi, Irene. Every point that you're trying to get to. And guess what? In the midst of you trusting him, in the midst of you fighting and going and working to get to that point, he's going to drop some more blessings on you. Some more other blessings on you. He's going to give you some more blessings. He's going to go, okay, I didn't know I was going to get that. God will reward you for your efforts. So that's what we want to tell you. And we want to tell you that you can make it, that you will make it. And remember the scripture that you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. You can do it. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm trying to get our Dr. Darlene back on the phone because, you know, she was preaching. We absolutely miss Dr. Milburn because that's another preacher right there that's always with us. So we absolutely miss you, Dr. Milburn, not being with us. He's out there making it right now. He's making it happen. So that's what he's bringing. That's the message today. You can make it. You can do it. I'm gonna see if I can get her back on this phone for 2 minutes before it may die. So she can put some more input on I made it. So yeah, I can jump. There's some things, you know, you might be want that house that you think you can't get. You can make it. You might want that car. It's a lot of things that you can make it. Sorry, Dr. Darlene, my phone died, and I'm trying to keep it up.
It's okay.
I had to call you on the 248 number. Yep, there it goes again. I had to use my other phone. But that car, that job, even that relationship. Some people are like, oh, Lord, I don't know how I'm going to get the relationship I'm looking for. You know, especially if you've been through all these different types of relationships and you're thinking, okay, I can't even find the right relationship to suit me. I'm a giving person. I'm a loving person. I try to do the right thing. I'm always giving. But when I get into a relationship, it doesn't seem to work out. Well, God could even fix that too. And then you can say, guess what? I made it. See, my parents stayed married until they both passed. So, yeah, I just want to say that it can happen. Just because you don't see it around, it's around. And if it's something that you really want, look, and if you got the, if you're the person with that kind of heart where you're really trying to do the right thing, and then if you just say a prayer about it, guess what? God will bring it to pass. Yes, he will. If that's what you want, he'll give you your heart desire. He can bring it to pass, and he will. He said that whatever you shall ask for in my name, I will do it. That's what he said. So, you know, we just got to be, not ask God questions or question God's word. We need to believe in his word. And you know, like people, when I was a little kid, I couldn't understand when people stand up in church. The old ladies get up. I know that. She know about 10 times that she know that she know that she know. Well, guess what? I understand what she knows now. And I word of God, I understand why she says she knows that she knows that she knows that God is real and this and this and that. Because it's true. And when you have the experience in your life to know that, then you'll be saying the same thing. I know that I know that I know. So, you know, God wants you to take that first step. Just believe him with the faith of a mustard seed. If you believe him with the faith of the mustard seed, you're going to get to the point where you're not just knowing with that faith of mustard seed, with your faith of a mustard seed can move a whole mountain.
Hi.
Yeah, you, she's back on my other phone. And I've just been going at it, Dr. Darlene, talking about the faith and knowing that God would give you your heart's desires. He said that in the scriptures. So just encourage the people. Today is the day of encouragement. Today is the day of saying you can make it. And some of you can say, I made it. Sometimes you say, I made it out of, you made it out of, you could have made it out of a situation.
Yeah.
Or you could have made it into a better situation.
Uh-huh.
Or you can have this desire over your heart that you've been going for. You know, sometimes people sit back on the sideline and they look like, how you gonna do that? If they don't understand, they don't understand. This thing said God fixed it when nobody understand, but he did it for you. And you know, I said, well, you know, the Lord give you the instructions on how to do certain things, but other people don't, they may not get it. Maybe those instructions are not for them. But sometimes it could be if people will listen. But God will give you instructions on how to get to this level, how to do this thing, how to obtain this, how to obtain that. He'll start you from scratch all the way to the top. And guess what? He'll turn around and give it to you. Thought you did what he said. You worked for it. You know, and we're not saying this things are going to fall out the sky. Maybe at certain points things do fall. I said, well, I've seen God make things appear out of nothing. You know, I've got 10 ways. You don't need the money for that. I'm just going to give you that. You know, I said, well, God has all these lessons he wants to teach us. But you know, just out of guidelines, rules, and regulations, we have to, God wants us to plan. He wants us to be in order. He wants us to follow directions. He wants us to persevere. That's in Proverbs. He wants us to, he said, if you can persevere, keep working at it. He even says you might even get discouraged sometimes. This thing ain't looking too rough for me, God. I don't know how this thing not working. He says you might even say that, but you know what he said? He said, keep working. Keep persevering. Don't stop. Keep going. Keep going. Keep going. And when you keep going, guess what? Next thing you know, you're going to say, I made it. I came out of that. And I made it to this point where you actually, people say, see light at the end of the tunnel? You see the light? And you made it. You made it. You made it. So we just want to encourage people with all this going on. You know, as long as you're living down here, as long as you're breathing, life is not over. And it's a frame of mind also if you feel like giving up. Some people actually feel like giving up. I even had one doctor was talking about, she said some people actually pass away because their mind gave up, not their body, but the mind gave up. You know, that's sad. So our mind is the first thing that the adversary wants to get into to play with. If he can make your mind his playground, then that's what happened to us.
What, you know, brother, that's why when I started talking, the Lord will keep you in perfect peace, not just a tiny little simple peace. I remember everything that you said about forgiveness, all that good stuff. But our mind—that's something that you just have to control. You know, in the sense of not control, but yielding your mind to God, yielding your mind to God. You know, and it's a choice that we make. God is not allowed, he does not have us as robots. He doesn't have us as puppets.
Right.
He's not going to say, well, you serve me or else. No, he said, whosoever will.
Let him come.
What we've been talking about is our different clues, different keys to being strong in the Lord. And a person has to make up their mind. Well, who are you going to serve?
Right.
You going to serve the devil? You going to serve the world? Or you going to serve God and his way of doing things? You know, and I like what you said about forgiveness, because forgiveness can put people into bondage. And forgiveness is supernatural, but it's not optional. It's mandatory.
Yeah.
In the Lord's Prayer, and all of us, I'm sure we learned ones that came up in church, we learned that as from little children.
Mm-hmm.
But Lord, forgive us our debts as we forgive others. See, okay, so we don't forgive us, don't forgive us. And then in Mark 11, you know, 23rd, that's the, you know, the anthem of strong faith.
Mm-hmm.
It said, wait, you go with your brother and then come back to the altar. And so, you know, God can give a person a strong mind, but we have to allow him to. And we have to, like, stand. There's no limit on God. And we have to know that we are children of God. We are strong. We are strong and mighty, not in ourselves, but of the Lord. And so, the first thing that we should do, don't compare your life to somebody else, because you said you don't know how they got where they did.
Right.
And some people, they're going, like, not through the street in their own way. They're not going and waiting on God. And there is a timing for all of us. But we just need to keep working, you know, just enjoying life. You know, you sitting there watching and looking at somebody else's life, that's their path. Their path is their path. Their call is their call.
Right.
And my daughter Marietta always says, you have to trust the process. You know, so we're not limited by our gender because we're females. We're not limited. We're not limited by our age.
Mm-hmm.
Moses didn't start his ministry until he was 80. We're not limited by economic status.
Mm-hmm.
We're not limited by ethnicity. I don't care what color, race, creed, color. We are not limited. We are children of God. God gave his son, Jesus Christ, to give us victory.
Amen.
And we can be victorious in every area of our life. And we have to keep in mind, Galatians 6 and 9 says, don't grow weary. Let us not grow weary in what I'm doing. You know, while we're working, while we're, you know, doing everything that we can do in our ability, it says, let us not grow weary in well doing.
Right.
For in due season, you shall reap if you faint not. Due season is not always what we think our season should be. Due season is God's season. Then Jeremiah 29:11 says, I know the plans I have for you. So we're not just like, oh, well, I thought, you know, wait a minute, I got to catch this. No, God has planned our lives.
Mm-hmm.
He knows the plans for us, plans to prosper us, and to give us an effect to end.
Mm-hmm.
So it's all in the timing of God. But on the way to what the fullness, I guess, or the total fruition of what God has planned for us, just enjoy your journey.
Amen.
Trust God. Be blessed. You know, you're prosperous. Know that. Enjoy your life, because the joy of the Lord is our strength.
Yeah.
Amen.
Enjoy. I know you have praise break to do in about 6 minutes, but I'm glad I'll be able to get you back on the phone. And if you can, we just
I pushed it back, London. I pushed the praise break back.
Oh, great.
I'm
happy.
I pushed it back. I'm going to do it later.
About that, because I just know, like, with this conversation, I just want to tell people, you go ahead and do it, go ahead and get it. And, you know, even with the mind, sometimes our mind is feeling down a little, you know, we're just going to pray that God will encourage people, bless them in their mind and bless them in their spirit to know that you can do it, that you can make it, and because God is the one that's at the forefront, and put him at the forefront so that, you you know that you can make it through Jesus Christ. He's our strength. He's our everything. So, you know, when you start giving God credit for everything and not ourselves, and even give when I was saying you're gifted, we're giving God credit for making you. God made you so awesome. God made you so great. So we're asking God to encourage you today. I've been telling you, obviously, people are at home, but they learn they're making new businesses because they're at home, you know, because they're not supposed to be going out right now as much, and so they're being creative. But God has given us such creativity, some of us that maybe never realized that, you know. So don't think less of yourself, just think more of God. Think of God, because God is a big God. And everything that God made is blessed. Whatever you decide to do, it's blessed. Even if we decide to go the other way, well, like you said, it's a choice. It's a choice that we can choose. And the Bible does say that we do have some type of control over the instruments of our, what we think, what we do, what we say. We do, you know, so we have to take responsibility for the things that we do and don't do. And we not to be, you know, sometimes you may have a little pity party, and I'm not saying don't have one, because sometimes you can have one for about a minute or two. I want you to come out of that pity party, though, and start looking up and start going, start moving, start doing, you know. Sometimes you said you had to shed a tear. Sometimes you shed a tear for a minute because something just didn't look right. Something didn't feel right. Something could have been very devastating to you, but because God is there, and we just, that's what that prayer is for. That's why we gotta pray. That prayer will bring us out. Talking to God will bring us out. Having faith will bring us out. Believing in God will bring us out. And sometimes you're so weak, you know, you'd be surprised if you just give yourself to the Lord. Even if you're very, 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 very weak, you just feel like, I'm too weak to pray, God. God will step in and pull you up. So we got it. You know, some people really feel downtrodden, beat down, tired. God, he said, let me go over here and deliver my child. You know, God see your spirit. He feels you. Even if you couldn't mumble a word, but he can feel you. And that's what's so good. I guess they call that the sovereign God. He'll come pick you up even when you didn't turn around and ask him. But sometimes I know things going on in life, sometimes it can be very... it can wear you out. You know, God says it rains on the just as well as the unjust. So, you know, even being a child of God, a Christian, he didn't say things was not going to come our way, you know. But the good thing about being in Christ Jesus is, boy, he can lift you up out of there. He'll bring you out. Some things, definitely, he will not even allow to touch you. Sometimes you see it. But sometimes just watching it is devastating. You're not in it. But you're watching it like, my God, it's devastating to the mind to see. But God still not yet let that thing touch you. So we, as the creatures that he made, he's our creator. We got to keep our mind stayed on the Lord.
Stayed on
the Lord and pray. Talk to him just like you're talking to your friend. And I like what Dr. Milburn had said one day. He said, you know, people think you got to go to get extravagant, but the Lord, you know, his mind is open to you just for you to just think in your heart and talk with him. I say, Lord, and tell God the truth, but he already knows the truth about us. Just be honest about it and just go ahead and pour your heart out into the Lord and talk to him. And that in itself, that's praying right there. When you're talking to the Lord, he's going to give you his ear and he's going to listen to you. So, but again, this topic today is London at the Table of Prayer with London. I made it. And guess what? There's more to come because you're going to make it some more. So we're not going to say we finished. We're not saying we finished. I don't think we believe that we'll be finished till we get all the way up there with God and took us home. Then we can say, then we're going to say, well done.
I would like to just encourage the ones that are listening. It's a lifestyle. Just like a person eats every single day, unless they're on a fast. you know. But see, some people, you gotta realize, you gotta feed your spirit, man. Mm-hmm. Not just once a week. You gotta. It's a lifestyle where God loves fellowshipping with His children. Mm-hmm. That's why it's more than a cliche. Matthew 6:33.
Right.
First, the kingdom of God. Jesus, give an example. Go on the Bible. The Bible is your handbook. You can't have wavering faith. Well, maybe it's God's word. No. Just, you know, people that want to try to make you think that it's not God's word. No. You need to let them know, no, this is my handbook. This is the promise of my Father. Mm-hmm. God is not a man that he should lie. He's not a promise breaker. He is a promise keeper.
Amen.
So what you do, you fortify. You've got to fortify your spirit, fortify your life in calm time. Mm-hmm. Because Jesus gave the example, there were two people that built their house.
Mm-hmm.
One built his house on a rock.
Mm-hmm.
He said, when the storm comes, he said, well, it might be a possibility. No, when the storm came, the house stood because it was built on a rock.
Mm-hmm.
How do you build your house on a rock? Mm-hmm. You spend time with God. You make time. And people have more time now. Take out time to talk to God.
That's
take
true.
Out time to read His word. Take out time like you're listening to this prayer table. You speak, you know, good ministry that was testing you. Now, the other example Jesus said, there was a man that built his rock on the sand. That meant this person, they're feeding their spirit just junk all day.
Yeah.
You know, just drama. Listen to lyrics that's full of cussing. Listen to lyrics that just not feeding you and strengthening you. You know, we can have a balance. We can have some entertainment in our life.
Mm-hmm.
But you best to believe you need to make a decision. I'm on God's side or I'm on the other side. And if I'm on God's side, Paul said, put on that whole armor. And so Jesus said, this man built his house on the sand.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't believe.
Right.
And when the storm came, he said, not only did the house fall, it was a great fall. So God, you know, God can just make us strong.
Yes.
And then when whatever comes along, we're not ourselves. Jesus said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. And so feed your faith. You feed your faith from God's word.
Amen.
You feed what you're hearing this now, this is absolutely feeding your faith. Because when you go on that timeline on Facebook, thank God for Facebook, you can stop at something you know good and well and just carry down your faith. So
mm-hmm.
you have to make a decision what you're going to feed yourself. Glory to God. Feed your faith. Don't feed your fear. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. And also, I wanted to leave this. Now, like you said, feed your faith, but also feed your faith. That's a pretty awesome saying right there. I wanted to read the scripture. Of course, it's Psalms 37:4. It says, delight thyself also in the Lord. It said also in the Lord. So, like you say, you can have great times in your life, entertainment, all that, but you delight yourself also in your Lord, in the Lord, and He shall give thee the desires of thine heart. And it's just as simple as that, but that is such a big, awesome, mega statement right there coming from the Word of God, that if we delight ourselves in the Lord, that He will give us the desires of thine heart. And, you know, there's nothing, no way to get mixed up about that. That's what God said that He will do. So
that's right.
So once again, back to saying, I made it. There's instructions in the Word for us to follow to show how. You know, the Bible even tells you how to make it. You know, out of all the books that we study in school and business classes and all this thing, you know, you start reading that word, all in the Proverbs. I mean, it'll tell you so many ways how you can actually make it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Without giving up, without doing something wrong, without compromising.
Yeah.
Just
right.
With the blessed anointed gifts that God has given you, the skills that God has given you, and all you got to do is just take it to the Lord in prayer, and He'll show you exactly what to do with it, how to do it.
Yes, He will.
Mm-hmm.
So
that is so true.
I'm not sure how long that we've been talking, but I just thought that came to my mind. I'm not sure if I totally can get that out of my heart and say it like I want to say it, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But when you get...
Dear Lord Jesus.
Dear Lord Jesus.
Lord Jesus Christ.
Lord Jesus Christ.
Come in my heart.
Come in my heart.
Come in my life.
Come in my life.
Save me.
Save me.
Forgive me.
Forgive me.
For all my sins.
For all my sins.
And my wrongdoings.
And my wrongdoings.
I'm so sorry, Lord.
I'm so sorry, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
For hearing my prayer.
For hearing my prayer.
And forgiving me.
And for forgiving me.
And washing away.
And washing away.
All my sins.
All my sins.
With the blood of Jesus.
With the blood of Jesus.
According to your word.
According to your word.
I'm right now.
I'm right now.
This very moment.
This very moment.
Born again.
Born again.
In right standing with you.
In right standing with you.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you for that. Pastor Darlene, I really appreciate that. There's a couple of scriptures that I got. I know we got to go. This is like the this is a big instruction that just,
okay.
That is the key, one of the key to that success. This is 1 Kings 2 and 3. It says, and observe what the Lord your God requires. Walk in obedience to him. Keep his decrees and commandments, his laws and regulations as written in the law of Moses. Do this so that you may prosper in all you do and wherever you go. Now that tells you right there, you're going to make it. Do those,
yeah.
You can say, and you'll be able to say, I made it. Because he's telling you right there that you're going to prosper, you're going to make it if you just do that right there. And there's one more scripture that I have that is Proverbs 16:3 says, commit to the Lord whatever you do. And he will establish your plans.
Oh, that's a good one.
Isn't that good?
Yes, that's a good one.
So,
yes. Thank you, Jesus.
Let's go to the rules of the word of God, and he will establish your plans. Just commit to the Lord.
Yeah.
That's what you do.
That's
and watch God work. Well, thank you so much. I know I'll be watching you doing your praise.
Amen.
Keep right on going and keep on praising God today. And thank you, everyone. I so apologize for being on so late for at the table of prayer with London, but thank God we're able to get it in. And we ask God to bless the ones that's not with us today. Bless him wherever he's at while he's working, and keep him safe. And also bless Dr. Octavia. She said keep her in prayer. She's trying to come back with us, and she's still trying to get things together. Dr. Pastor Sarah, bless Pastor Sarah. We are kind of like those. We are like the key people that always come back and do these things. So, keep all of y'all in prayers and pray for everybody's safety. Thank you once again. And I am going to play a little tad of this with Antasia. Talk about she made it, so you can feel this.
Yeah,
cool.
Through the storm and the rain. So much pressure, high, that's so
much. Thank you for tuning in.
Hey,
so this is London. I'm going to give a shout out to Miss Irene and CBS Washington. CBS TV is watching the new bandits are Linda Logan Thompson. Thank you, Pastor Octavia. Thank you, Pastor Anthony King, Joseph Davis, Donna J. Riggs, LaSandrell Page.
God bless you. I want you to
a little bit of heat. See you later.